So what are some of your impressions of what you're seeing there? You can just call out what you, what. Yeah, beautiful colors, yes. And what's interesting is each different color is indicates that that food has special nutrients or phytonutrients from plant foods that, maybe the other foods don't. Like the red could be several different things. The green, any green leafy vegetable we're finding is really one of the best brain foods among everything in the vegetable kingdom. That's why I have so many different ones. And then the purple of the eggplant is another set of nutrients. And one of the latest green leafy vegetables, I don't know if you've had a chance to see it. It only was introduced where I shop at Idlewild in Acton about a month or two ago. It's a combination, it's a cross between kale and Brussels sprouts. So these are all like little baby kales, and they grow up on the stalk like Brussels sprouts. So when you pick them, they're ready to eat. You just wash them, throw them in the steamer or saute pan, and they're ready in minutes, and they got a little purple color, so that's good. And then onions come in yellow and purple, and I've got red tomato with lots of lycopene, and then they're beta carotene in the carrots. So each color signifies a different set of nutrients. Not that I know one for one which all the nutrients are for each color, but you want to eat a variety of color. Now, the other thing you might notice is there's lots of different types of foods up here. I don't have a lot of packaged foods because the closer we are to Whole Foods, the better. So I don't really have anything much processed. But some things have to be packaged to keep them fresh. So for instance, some of my spices and herbs, which are really, really potent brain foods, some of them are in little jars or bottles to keep them fresh. But mostly they're pure, whatever they are, they're pure. And one thing that Methuen Village has is we have on every table, I'm not sure, I might have, the cinnamon, I keep using up. Here's the cinnamon. We have in every resident's table cinnamon and spice of life, which is a mixture of 21 different spices and herbs, which this was inspired by Trader Joe's 21 Seasoning Salute. But this particular mixture, spice of life, that senior living residents has put together is unique, and the only way you can get it is to visit Methuen Village or one of the other senior living residences. And I'm very proud of them because we were finding the spices were so popular with the residents and improved the taste of the food that they wanted to have their own brand of spices instead of having Trader Joe's spices with their own little, you know, sometimes we put little stickers that said Methuen Village on the top. So this made more sense. And what I'm really proud about is that the cinnamon they chose is the best quality and the best tasting that you can buy. And it's you don't see it every day. It's the Vietnamese or Saigon cinnamon. And I'll tell you why they chose it, because of the flavor, but also because it's the cassius type cinnamon. And I'll get back to that, but that is the best cinnamon for your heart and your brain. And it comes in two varieties, Chinese and Vietnamese. They're both good. They both do the same thing in the body and the brain, but the Vietnamese tastes better. So I'm really proud that they spent the extra money to make sure their residents had that. So you're seeing lots of produce, vegetables and fruits. And you can see I have even more vegetables than I have fruits. And that's for a reason, because all the evidence is saying vegetables are really, really key to our health, both our brain and our body. Even more than the fruits. The fruits are important because they have unique nutrients too, but if we ate fruit all day and didn't eat our vegetables, we could be in trouble because there's also sugar in the fruit. And there's sugar, a little sugar in some of our root vegetables as well. And the way nature gives it to us in the whole food is the way we want to eat the sugar that we eat. And I'll get into why that's so. Why is sugar something we have to pay attention to? And then over here we have, as I indicated, a basket of herbs and spices. And then over here, I've kind of put these all together. Some of this is grains, some of it is seeds, some of it is nuts. And what they all have in common is, in their raw form, you could take the seed or the grain and plant it and make a whole plant. These are whole foods that Of course, once they're processed as spaghetti, we cannot make a plant. But it's got, this is, happens to be whole wheat spaghetti. So before they turned it into spaghetti, I could have taken that wheat grain and planted it, get a new wheat plant. So what all of these foods have in common is, as I said, they've got everything in them that you would need to grow a new plant from scratch. And somehow my garlic got in there. It belongs over here. though I could plant that and make a new, you know, in fact, this would make 10 garlic plants. This is one of the easiest plants to grow. I don't know if you've tried it. I can't grow everything in my little vegetable garden, but garlic always grows. So the idea is, we want to eat whatever food category, we want to eat as close to nature as possible, because all the research is showing the more processed foods we eat, the more in trouble we are. And there's a lot of reasons for that. But every one of these foods that is a whole grain or a whole bean or lentil or nut is great for our brains and our body. Then over here, what we have is healthy fats. And you'll see something like nuts is in both places. It's both over here as a whole nut or seed, and it's over here as a source of healthy fats. And that's because every nut, I like to say every nut brings something to the table. So that's why I gave you a choice today of either the almonds or a mixture of nuts that included almonds and walnuts. Every time some researcher does research on a different nut, they're going to find good things. We already know that every nut they've tested lowers cholesterol, will help you lose weight, helps your blood sugar stay under control. And then as we start looking at, does it have a direct, so that's all good for our heart. And that's, we know anything good for our heart is going to have indirectly a good effect on our brain. But as they started testing different nuts, we're finding some of them are all, well, they've only tested a few. The two that they've tested, almonds and walnuts, which in lore has been what people have often recommended to me even 10 years ago is great for the brain. Now it's been shown and proven with mice, Alzheimer's mice, that indeed it helps. They help protect the brain. And I would guess that every time they would test a different nut, they might find the same thing, even though almonds and walnuts are very different. What walnuts have in them is the omega-3 fats that are really, really important for our brains. And the almonds have monounsaturated fatty acids, as does olive oil and some of the other oils. I usually have canola oil here. And the walnuts have the omega-3s similar to what's in flaxseed. And what else the almonds have is a lot of vitamin E. So we need vitamin E to protect our brains from deterioration. But they're also, every nut and seed has a little bit of vitamin E. And some of the newer fats on the market, I usually have my little bottle of palm oil, which somehow not everything is here, but what we're finding is palm oil, which you use for baking, when it's in its semi-refined state, is white. It looks like Crisco. It is the best source of the rarest forms of vitamin E called tocotrienols. So that's kind of a relief to know. We're getting rid of trans fats, and palm oil and coconut oil often had bad reputations because, number one, in earlier years, they were often available only as partially hydrogenated oils, which are trans fats and which are not good for us. But in their natural state, they have a lot of saturated fats. And for a while, we thought all saturated fats are bad for us. And that's still the predominant belief. But my nutrition expert friends are telling me the more they research plant-based saturated fats, the more they're finding that they have redeeming qualities. And as long as you're not eating them all day long, they are full of other nutrients that are good for us. So the palm oil has the tocotrienols, the very important type of vitamin E. And coconut oil, you probably, some of you may have heard, it's even being looked at as a possible treatment for people who already have Alzheimer's because of the mid-chain triglycerides that are part of it. That research may go nowhere, but it is being looked at seriously, and those are considered healthy fats. So I've started using coconut oil in a lot of my baking recipes. And now I've learned that palm oil, I don't know, any of you watch Dr. Oz? I was doing updating my work on palm oil, so I went to the internet. I always check out research, but I also look at what's floating around the internet. And what came up was the first week of January, Dr. Oz had a person on another medical doctor, who was going into great detail why it was like he had freshly discovered palm oil, as it is used in its native way of processing in Africa, as they called it the new miracle food. Well, there are many, all of these are miracle foods, by the way. So when you hear that term, you know, take it not too seriously, because there are many miracle foods, and often people are using that term to try to make you pay a lot of money for something that may not, like I say, berry is probably not much better for you than cranberries and blueberries, but you could pay a lot of extra money for it. It's good to have a variety, but back to the palm oil story, it turns out that in its native form, the way it's been used for centuries in Africa, and then as Africans have been, are populating other continents, they brought the palm oil with them. Well, what it looks like, and I had hoped to have a bottle to show you, it's red. It's red and orange, so it's partly a pulpy kind of substance and partly oil, and that oil is bright red and yellow. And what they've found is that that's where the key nutrition is, that helps protect you against all sorts of things, heavy-duty antioxidants. You know where palm oil comes from are these red date-like things. And they squeeze them and, you know, crush them to get the oil out. And they minimally process it mainly to get as much oil as they can out of the date. They don't take the color out. They leave that in, it's used as the main cooking oil. And it turns out that as we look at what are the other nutrients in palm oil as it's been used for centuries, that's the healthiest part of it. The oil itself is fine too, but it's those red and orange colors that are really like the miracle part of the oil. So what have we done? We have taken out all those beautiful, strong tasting colors to make a white palm oil. Now, the only advantage it gives us is that strong color, strong flavored and strong colored original palm oil is really too strong tasting to use in baking. It would not taste good in your cakes or your cookies or apple crisps. It's great if you're making stews and meat and seafood dishes and vegetable dishes. So I'm going to be busy learning some of those recipes, as you can imagine, and sharing them with you. So it's just what we find with practically any of these foods is if you start tampering with it as Mother Nature gave it to us, you are losing a lot of the nutrition. And one of the fun topics today is chocolate. Okay, so I'll get into that story. But what do I have way over here at the end? You probably can see what I have. But these are all safe sweeteners. Some of them have no sugar at all. None of them are artificial. And some of you have seen maybe some of these. Like, one that's been around, I usually have my bottle of molasses, but we were doing a baking show yesterday, so I think a lot of my baking supplies didn't make it into the display here. But molasses, for instance, has been around a long time, and its dark color tells you it's got most of the nutrition that was in the original sugar cane. So if you're going to use anything from sugar cane, use molasses. Again, it has a strong flavor, so you're not using it in certain things if you don't want that molasses flavor. Okay, a lot of people have learned they can use dried fruits in their baking or cookie making. This used to be full of those cute little sunsweet ones, the prunes. I don't know if you've had them. They're absolutely delicious. They're not pitted, there's no pits, and they taste like the most delicious fruit flavored candy you ever had. And it's because they're individually packaged and they're moist. If you haven't had one, even if you don't like prunes, give it a try. I passed them out at Halloween, and I had a lot of takers in my neighborhood. And then, of course, more traditional is the little raisins. Yes? Honey. Okay, I have honey here. I've got two bottles of honey. Okay. And they're both, one's from Maine and one's from more local, Deerfield, South Deerfield, Mass. And they both say in big letters, but you can't read it back there, raw honey. So what I've learned is that if you're going to have honey, it is a sugar. It is a real sugar. And it will, and in fact, it has a lot of fructose. So if you're going to use honey at all, you want to use it raw, because when they process it and it's in those cute little bears, guess what? It's no longer good for you, because they've taken out a lot of the good nutrients, and the glycemic index is twice what it is in its raw state. So what we're trying to prevent is refined sugars that go straight to destroying our brain and our bodies, which I will get into a little more. But raw, I've got raw honey. And one thing we'll be passing around is, and maybe you already have tasted it in the little cups.
It's delicious.
You want to know what it is? It's coconut sugar. Soon it's going to be all over on the market. Some people can find it in their grocery store. I found it in my local, I live in Acton, and I found it in Deborah's Gourmet in West Concord. But it is developed from the coconut flour, the sap of the coconut flour. Who knew? And it has very low glycemic index, and it's considered safe for people with diabetes. Celiac means you're gluten intolerant. So it has nothing to do with it. It's gluten-free. I mean, there's no gluten in any coconut. What?
You mentioned it came from the flour.
The sap of the coconut palm flour. So they use all parts of, and I guess maybe, I don't know its history of its use in native cultures, whether it's been used for centuries or they hadn't figured that out yet. I don't know, but it's new on the American market. And of course, because we're all looking for how do we decrease obesity, how do we decrease our risk of diabetes if we have it, how do we eat safely, and we're looking to keep our food delicious. So what I have here is some products that are have real sugar in it, so you can't eat it all day long, but they're lower glycemic index, so you can eat some of it safely. And then I'm going to talk about others that have no sugar. Yes? It's still, it's really close to white sugar.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. A lot of the brown colored sugars, they are not much safer for you than pure white refined sugar. They go right to raising your insulin levels and making trouble for you. So you really want to avoid it to the extent you can. White sugar, turbinado, raw sugar, they call it all different things. Cane syrup, they're all not. They all have very high, what they call high glycemic index, and when we eat too much of it, I'll start listing all the things that it does bad for us. So what I'm trying to introduce to you, that doesn't mean that you avoid it altogether, because you can safely eat a small amount if you're eating all these other foods. Because guess what? All these other foods help your body keep your blood sugar under control. But you have to eat more of these than sugar in order to keep whatever sugar you're eating under control. Your whole grains help you. All of these omega-3s and healthy fats help you. All the fruits, all the vegetables, especially the vegetables and the spices are really potent. So is cocoa powder, the raw cocoa powder. So again, I'll be talking a little more about what mix of chocolate and sugar can we eat safely. So thank you for asking that question about the brown sugar or the raw sugar, the turbinado, because they're all presented in a way to make us think they're safer or better for us. They're really not. Luckily, we have a lot more choices today than we did. So the coconut sugar, I just introduced you to it. It's not widely available, but I predict it will be, and other people have been finding it in their markets. So it is a wonderful product. You can substitute it cup for cup for brown sugar or the white sugar. And what we've been doing, and I'll share some of the recipes with you, is we've been taking whatever a recipe calls for, whether it was white sugar or brown sugar, and we kind of mix up what we substitute. You can substitute applesauce for part of that in many baked products, and it'll make your any kind of cake or muffin or cookie a little, it also adds moisture. You can add, you can substitute coconut sugar for part of it. And then what I like to do, I like to substitute something with stevia in it for another part of the sweetness that I'm looking for. But you only need a little bit of stevia for a lot of sugar. Because if you have pure stevia, which comes in a white powder, it is 200 times sweeter than sugar. So you need like a little pinch. And it, some people like the flavor of pure stevia, some don't. And so what some of the manufacturers have been doing is taking the stevia and mixing it with something else. And the something else is really important what it is, because some of them are good for us and some aren't. You'll see a lot of, this is very confusing when you're trying to eat well. Let's say you have diabetes and you want a sugar-free product, and you go and you get one, says 100% sugar-free, and it's got lots of maltodextrin in it. And maltodextrin is a starch that will spike your blood sugar faster than sugar ever dreamed of doing. So why would they do that? I mean, it's very, and sometimes they'll take the stevia and mix it with maltodextrin. Or they'll, some of the products mix it with dextrose, which is corn sugar. How many of us know dextrose is a sugar? But anything OSE has probably got a sugar in it. So I see we have some knowledgeable people with us, which I'm, so if you have anybody who knows additional information, please feel free to share, it would be great. So there are a few products where they tried to take another safe natural product to mix it with the stevia to give a nicer flavor. So there's a couple, Truvia is one, Purvia is another. And then I also, before these companies came into being, there's this one called Sweet Leaf. So their little packets look like this. And what they mixed the stevia with was a very safe fiber called inulin, which actually helps your blood sugar control and is a very safe thing to spread out the flavor of the stevia. Originally, these people weren't allowed to market their product as a sweetener. They had to trademark the word sweetener to get away with it. Did you know that it was outlawed in this country first to have stevia at all, because the artificial sugar makers, it was NutraSweet that got them outlawed in the first place. NutraSweet is, if you have too much of it, is a neurotoxin. And I forget what color packet that is. Equal maybe? I don't know. But they got it, sweet stevia outlawed. It was came to us from South America at the time. Then eventually a bunch of our Congress people, this was in the day where we actually had active action in Congress, kind of reached a compromise where you could bring it into the country, but you couldn't call it a sweetener. You could call it a natural flavor. Well, what big company is going to use a product that they can't say is a sweetener? I thought that was horrible. So now, sometimes you're glad when big companies get into the action. So Cargill is the one that manufactured this. Purvia is a slightly different formulation, and they're out of New Zealand. And I think it was Coke and Pepsi had turned to Cargill asking them to come up with a safe, non-artificial product that they could put in their sodas to make them safer for their for their diet sodas, so they wouldn't have to have artificial and they could call them green. So what's in here? If anyone wants to taste this later, the other thing besides stevia is called erythritol. Most of you have not seen this. You'll see it only in a health food store. Very interesting. I'll pass around the bottle and you can shake it and look at it. It looks like sugar. It is a sugar alcohol and it tastes like a weak form of sugar. Exactly, very much the same, except it has a surprising sensation, and you might notice that if you have Truvia. If anybody wants to take a Truvia packet home and try it, I'll pass this around. I usually have, and I have a little sweet leaf left too. By the way, I just share products that I've discovered that I like. I wish that somebody was paying me money to talk about them, but nobody is. And it makes me more objective that nobody's paying me to advertise. So anyway, so the erythritol is the same sweet taste that's in pears, melons, and white grapes. So our bodies know how to handle it. Some of the sugar alcohols are not so common in nature. They'll be in birch trees or something, you know, that we wouldn't eat, so our body doesn't know what to do with it. So this erythritol is less likely to give people digestive issues. Like xylitol was the big popular one before that. Your dentist may still have dental products with xylitol. In small amounts, it's fine, but if you have too much of it, it often gives people the run. So naturally, a big company wasn't going to put it in their sugar substitute. So that's what Truvy is. They now have it in a form you can spoon out. And the mixture is such that they say you can use it one-to-one with white sugar, but I find it more sweet than sugar. So I wouldn't do that. I would use less. So I find, and a lot of bakers do this, that to get a good flavor, you don't need to take just one product to switch out for the white sugar. You can mix some. So because if you use Truvia or Stevia or the sweet leaf, any of those, you're giving your body no sugar. It's not even a safe sugar. It's no sugar. It does not affect your insulin at all. So that's great, because we really need to do that as much as we can. Then you can take the other half of your sweetener. And some people do that for 100%, and that's perfectly good too. Then for the other half of your sweet, you can use your raw honey, you could use molasses, you could use applesauce, or you could use the coconut sugar. So you've got lots of options. You just have to be creative and experiment. And there's a lot of, you know, with the internet, there's other people out there that have done this before us, so that you don't have to just, if you don't feel like being experimenting because you want the cake to come out or the cookies to come out right the first time, let someone else do that trial and error work. So any other questions? I just want to mention, because I have a really good website now called brainwellness.com, and I usually have a sign-up sheet for those who would like to get a copy of my free emailed newsletter. I didn't bring the sign-up forms, but maybe Valerie could find a blank side of paper and pass that around. But on my website, I put a blog about Halloween sweets, because I have been working, you know, how as a brain health expert can I hand out candy at Halloween? I can't do that. So over the years, I have experimented. And first I would have, maybe 5 years ago, I had some kind of what I considered a safer candy, like a dark chocolate something, or something with almonds in it. And then I thought, well, let me see what happens if I have no candy at all, dark chocolate or not, you know, not even dark chocolate. So this year I added, so I've been using apples. In my neighborhood, I'm in Acton, so people are over the scare about razor blades and the apples, and the kids love that. Was still every year is the number one most popular thing, and I try to go to the orchards and find apples that are a little smaller, but even the great big ones, the kids love them. So out of 110 kids that came, I think 40 of them, I ran out of apples. Then I think it's on my website exactly what was the next most popular, but I think it was the fruit roll-ups. But if you're using fruit roll-ups, you've got to make sure they're 100% fruit. Just like when you're choosing a fruit juice, you really got to raise the label, because they're always trying to sell this high fructose corn syrup because it's cheap and it's horrible for us. They don't sell it to us because it's horrible for us, but they can make more money on it. And there are several brands. This one is Full Circle Organic Real Fruit. They're delicious. They come in different flavor. The kids love them. And then I also tried the raisins. Raisins are a longtime favorite with kids. And I also gave them the choice of the little sunsweet ones. And I also, what else? I had one other thing. But, nuts. I always pass out the little packets of nuts that you got. Those are also very popular. And out of 110 kids, I think I only had maybe four or five that have nut allergies and couldn't take that. And the last 2 years, I had none this year and only two last year, and let's assume the kids are actually being honest, only two said, "Where's the candy?" They were two little 10-year-old girls. And so my response is, well, all these other foods taste good, great with the candy that you already have. But I've had great success, so I do suggest that you experiment and choose foods that you like, because I'm sure in the past you've chosen candy that you like because you're going to get stuck with some of it, right? So anyway, that my theory was I didn't want to have any candy left. So if I don't include any, then I don't have to worry. So that's part of the story about that we have lots of options here. Of all the healthy fats, the most important to get more of is the omega-3s, because our brains are made of the animal or fish form of omega-3s. And if you don't eat fish, then look into perhaps a fish oil. And if you don't want anything to do with, like you're vegan, there are actually marine oils made from algae, because the omega-3s in the fish actually come originally from algae and plant life that the smaller fish ate and converted into the animal or fish form. And I call it the animal or fish form because it turns out that our farm animals used to be full of it too, until we stopped feeding them grass. This is why farm animals that are raised on grain, especially mostly corn, are so unhealthy that they have to give them antibiotics. And why, as you know, in the last century, we eat more meat than our ancestors did, but it's unhealthier meat because they're not free range. And a lot of us, I certainly didn't know why is free range so much healthier? Well, it's because they were eating grass and vegetables. And the grass and vegetables were, and the weeds were full of omega-3s and vitamin E, carotene, and all these other nutrients that we're starting to learn about that are absolutely key to keeping our hearts and our brains healthy. Now, when the farm animals ate them, and even the chickens and the turkey, a good part of their diet is plant life. Most people don't know that. They're digging up the roots of the grass. They eat a little bit of grass and vegetation. And even the insects that they eat are full of good things. So then their flesh gets the omega-3s in it. When we ate them, we would get it. Now they don't have any. If you can go and look it up, but after a cow has been on the feedlot, I think it's just 4 or 5 months. If they had been free-range, let's say when they were young, and then brought into the barn or the feedlots and fed only grain, they lose all of their omega-3s and most of the other good nutrients that was in their flesh. So this is one reason why we have to eat our vegetables, because we're not getting those nutrients from anything else. Now the fish are, we haven't messed with our fish population as much as we have with our farm animals, but of course we are starting to do, or have been some time, some of our fish is farm raised. And there again, it's going to be key, what are they feeding them? If they're feeding them corn, guess what? They won't have any omega-3s in them either. So, and it's really hard to know, you know, to investigate, okay, if you see farm raised fish on a label, and it could be tilapia, it could be any of our fish, you don't know what they fed them, and it would take quite a bit of research to find out, did they feed them algae or sea vegetables or other fish so that they have what we want them to have in their flesh? So much easier to eat, to buy wild caught and just eat less, because it will be more expensive. But we often are eating more of the protein part of our meal than we really need. And so I say, well, have less of your wild caught salmon than, you know, a bigger piece of your farm raised. It also tastes a lot better. I don't know if you noticed. So I like things that taste good. I go to different markets, but you just have to look, because some markets are, and it sometimes changes by the week what they offer. And sometimes you have to ask, sometimes they put right on it that it's wild or wild caught or native. But it's, if you investigate, and sometimes a grocer, even those big stores, If you ask for a product, they will, chances are they will bring it in. Because one customer asked for it, there's probably 100 other or 1,000 others that want it but didn't think to ask for it. And that's how you're going to get coconut sugar and some of these other newer products in your store. Well, any questions so far? And then I want to talk about sugar and dark chocolate for a little bit. Okay. Whenever I share something that is not, oh, here's my molasses. This is actually my little basket of some of the ingredients that go in our baked goods. And one of the recipes that you got from my, I didn't introduce my colleague, Valerie Gramolini. She's so faithful working back there. We've been friends a long time. And Valerie likes to work with me, and I like to work with her. She has a long, wonderful history as a social worker working with Alzheimer's and other patients. So one thing she passed out to you is a blue sheet, and it has two recipes on it. One is apple crisp, and the other one is yogurt parfait banana. I think it's the banana yogurt parfait recipe. Those are examples I have now. It's ready to go to the printer. This is just for our chefs. It's a 3-volume cookbook that actually takes up this much shelf space with 300 recipes, and then another volume about all our ways, what we look for when we're designing a menu and a recipe. Well, one of the things you do with recipes, and you'll see, is that I did the sugar substitution that I mentioned. I used only, in the apple crisp, I only used coconut sugar and Truvia. And I used also apple cider. That's very sweet. When I cook my apples, I mainly make a glaze. You take apple cider and you bring it to a boil, add a little arrowroot, which is a lot safer for us than cornstarch, and add a little cinnamon and a little Truvia, add the apples, and then meanwhile you prepare the crisp. And what you want to do there is take away the white flour and use instead a whole wheat flour. And if you use whole wheat pastry flour, it's almost as light and fluffy as white flour. So the key is to play around with your whole wheat flours. If the first thing you tried was the whole wheat stone ground, that isn't specially for baking, it will be really heavy. And it'll work well in some baking recipes and not well at all in others. So look for your whole wheat pastry flour. It's made from a harder grain that's white in color. There's also white whole wheat, but the white whole wheat pastry flour is your best. So I use that, and then oats, by the way, are naturally whole grain. So anything that calls for oatmeal, any kind of oats, is fine just as it is. Now, I added to that, as I said, the coconut sugar, Truvia, and of course I put in a lot of spices. Why? Because all these spices help control your blood sugar, lower cholesterol. They're all potent antioxidants and they're anti-inflammatory. And if you look at the one sheet summary, it says Methuen Village at the top. The reason we emphasize the spices is they are so potent, there's hardly any calories, and increases your insulin level, and it also increases all by itself your body's ability to make cholesterol. Most people don't know that about sugar. Yes?
I just want to say there's a few people that are getting a ride home around 5 o'clock.
Okay.
So if we could stop in a few minutes to give them a chance to eat a little bit, and then.
Okay.
But I mean, as long as you want to go, for
okay.
Else,
right. Okay. All right. So cinnamon, I'm just using as a sample spice because a lot of these do similar things, like turmeric almost has the same profile as cinnamon, even though it's very different spice. So cinnamon, they already did clinical trials with humans. They established the blood sugar action and that it lowers cholesterol. All by itself, about a teaspoon a day would lower your cholesterol by 8% on average. That's quite a punch for one spice. Mostly we're saying eat this variety of foods, like fish 3 times a week, lots of vegetables every day, fruit 2 or 3 times a day. Use as many herbs and spices as you possibly can get into you. If you like some, use more of them, and then maybe experiment. But a lot of people don't have time for that, so that's why a mixture of spices and herbs, like Trader Joe's 21 Season Salute or this one or any other no-salt spice and herbs are good. Do you want
one of the things for cinnamon, you can use it in a lot of very creative ways. I put cinnamon in my coffee, which is something that can sweeten it. I also put it when I have cereal, like Cheerios or any other kind of cereal. So there's a lot of different ways that you can use it.
Okay. A lot of people think of just using it on applesauce and oatmeal, so I'm glad you brought that up. I'm one that uses it in my coffee every morning because I like that flavor and I can put it in my tea. And then most recently, what we found about some of these spices that we already knew were good for our hearts and our bodies is they have a direct effect on the brain. Cinnamon, now so far, most of the studies have been done either small human clinical trials or with mice. So with cinnamon, they worked with mice in Israel. They were bred to have Alzheimer-like disease. And this, the cinnamon they used interrupted the buildup of this beta amyloid, which is part of the problem proteins that build up in Alzheimer's, and actually got it out of the brains. Almost as effective as some of these medications you've been hearing that they're going to be experimenting with that may or may not be safe. But cinnamon is safe unless you eat like over 2 tablespoons a day, which most of us are not going to do. But you'd be surprised if I say, if some people hear something's great in a small amount, they want to eat tons. And you can get into trouble doing that. There's some things like, I don't think you can eat too many green leafy vegetables. So you can eat, and I have a variety here. So that to inspire you, I've got Swiss chard, dandelions, bok choy, escarole, and chicory, this new kale, Brussels sprouts, cabbages, broccoli. They're all great. And then over here, in the herb spices, I've got parsley, cilantro, and dill, because, so are they an herb or are they a green vegetable? They act as both. Anytime you see the green leaf, you're going to be getting some omega-3s and you're going to get probably a little vitamin E. But parsley and cilantro help your blood pressure. This used to be the treatment for blood pressure before our current medications came along. I learned that from a nurse friend of mine. So they take them very seriously. Why did people discover America from Europe? Not that other people hadn't already discovered us, but it was to look for spices. They were so valuable. They helped preserve food. They also were used for medical treatment. And the cinnamon, we now know, kills a whole bunch of different meat-spoiling bacteria. So that's why the Greeks use cinnamon in almost all their meat dishes. Okay, I'm going to, because I have a few minutes, what?
You're going to talk about chocolate?
Yeah, yeah. So I'm going to mention just a few of the ways that sugar hurts us when we have too much. And it's kind of shocking, but apparently in about 1900, the average American ate 5 pounds of sugar a year. And at that level, your body can handle that. Today, this is on average, so that means some people eat more, some less, 135 pounds. A year? This is America. Because the manufacturers sneak it into everything. Everything tastes sweet because they're going after our money through our sweet buds. And all of us have a strong, we taste sugar and we like it. We like fat. I mean, these are things, those taste buds helped us survive when we were cave people and, you know, over the millennia. Now we have to use our brains to choose which sweet taste to go for. Okay, so what sugar does when you have too much of it, and we're finding this out in all the different areas of research, already mentioned, it by itself can raise cholesterol. Now there's no cholesterol in any plant product. It's a purely an animal phenomena. We need cholesterol to live. It's in every cell in our brain and body. Too much, however, especially when it's oxidized, it gets sticky, the low density protein. It gets sticky, sticks to the inside of our blood vessels and can cause all sorts of havoc because it's also getting inflamed. Now, the sugar somehow helps decrease the size of the LDL particles, which makes it easier to oxidize. Now, the other thing it does, it creates inflammation throughout our body, in our brains and in our bodies. We know inflammation is bad. We can feel it when we have arthritis. A lot of people are taking all these drugs and maybe even fish oil and ginger to help their arthritis pain, and then go and eat a ton of sugar, and they have no clue they're countering all their medicines and wonder why they still hurt. This can start affecting you, you know, like if you're a young person in your 20s working out. So that, and then what it does to the brain is it actually shrinks the memory part of our brain. Now this is very scary. People who already have diabetes or pre-diabetes, that memory part of our brain called the hippocampus is already shrinking. This has been established through imaging. So even kids in their 20s that are our most common new diabetes patients have this phenomena. Eventually, luckily we're born with extra brain cells even there, so it takes years and maybe decades to build up. But eventually, this is why a lot of people with diabetes have cognitive issues. The other thing is that it increases the rate of this buildup of the beta amyloid protein all by itself. And so you want to not have excess sugar. And it's partly because our brain lives on sugar. It's its only form of energy that we have to be so careful about how we feed it to ourselves. It's the brain is used to getting it in a gentle way, in whole grains, beans, nuts, apples, carrots, beets. So we have to be very careful. So how can we counter this? Because we know we're going to get a lot of sugar no matter what we do. Well, you do it by, as I said, eating more of all these, especially your spices. And one lucky thing is that there is one confection, and one of your handouts goes into great detail about this, dark chocolate. Now, dark chocolate, I can put my cocoa powder in multiple baskets. I could say it's as powerful as these spices. It comes from a nut, so it could be over here. It's got healthy a lot of healthy fats along with the saturated fats, so it could be here. Now, the beautiful thing about cocoa powder is if you have a confection that's at least 60 or 70% dark chocolate, that is the cocoa solids, like I've got a bag of what it looks like if you've never tasted it, that's so powerful, it will lower your blood sugar and lower cholesterol, even though the other 30, 40% is sugar and cocoa butter. So that's pretty cool, huh? Now, what we don't know is, okay, for how much good stuff do I need to eat to allow myself to eat 10 donuts? I don't know. I think it's safer not to eat 10 donuts. But it's pretty well established that you can safely eat this much dark chocolate every day and be healthy. That's quite a lot. This is 1.65 ounces or 47 grams. So most of the studies say eat anywhere from up to 40 grams. And so this is right about at that mark. This happens to be a Trader Joe's product, but there's many other great dark chocolate products. I look for ones that have no milk or dairy in them because it's sometimes better. This one says it's used on equipment shared with wheat, milk, and eggs. So it's this particular bar, they can't claim gluten-free, but it probably is gluten-free. Both my kids, by the way, discovered they're half Italian, that they one is celiac and the other is gluten intolerant, and he's a priest, so he's got to eat low gluten wafers. But so when I make my apple crisp, I easily can switch out all the flour and use instead almond meal and quinoa flakes. So your handout on dark chocolate, if you look at all the list of benefits, if I was to give you a list of the benefits, which I do, and if I would put the list of all the problems that sugar cause, the dark chocolate seems to counter it. So it's anti-inflammatory, it helps lower cholesterol, it helps as a strong antioxidant, and it seems to boost your brain power, though we don't have a lot of research on that yet. So, and that's kind of, I like to end on a happy note because many of us love chocolate. And if you haven't made the switch from milk chocolate to dark chocolate, I really urge you to do that, because what is milk chocolate? And you may not know, but the history of chocolate in this country, it started here in the Boston area, and it was touted as a health drink, and it was, because it was before they adulterated it too much. Yes, in Europe, where first the chocolate came from South America to Europe, they added a little sugar, because the natives in Peru and other places that grew it, what they did was just mix it with cayenne. It was served as a very savory, delicious drink, but it was very strong flavored. So the Europeans added a little sugar. And that was fine, because I just explained you can add quite a bit of sugar and not ruin its healthfulness. So it wasn't until somebody got the idea, well, gee, it's awfully strong flavored. Let's see if we can get rid of those strong flavors. And then they started processing it. It's called Dutching it. And the more they worked at it to make their confections just sweeter and sweeter, they were taking out all the antioxidants that were so powerful. Or not all of them. They say there's still like 10% left. And then they were adding milk and milk fat. So they were substituting a healthy plant-based product for partly dairy. And that's another whole story, but dairy is really not as good for you as our U.S. Department of Agriculture would have you believing. So I would urge you to make the switch. I used to, when I was younger, ate a lot of milk chocolate, and now it tastes insipid to me. So your tastes do change, whether it's trying to have less salt or less sugar craving, you can do it. It's really all up to you. But it is now 5 o'clock. I'm gonna be here to answer questions. But meanwhile, we have some delicious food for people. And
I just wanted to our...
Oh, yes, there you are again. Thank you very much.
So for those of you who are watching the show, I'm Ann Mary Connor, the Amesbury Council on Aging Director.
Oh, great.
Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for hosting me. This is wonderful. What a great audience you have.
So for those of you who don't know, you were coming to us through the Amesbury Caregiver Essential Program, which is the ACE program, which Methuen Village partners up and they help us. And they bring you out, and you're actually joining us also at our West Newbury Council on Aging and the Groveland Council on Aging. So if you're interested in finding out those dates, you can just give Ashley Stewart a call here at the center, because that's later on in the year.
Right, and it's also on my brainwellness.com website.
Yeah.
I like to help people know, because this is wonderful what you're doing.
Thank you, yeah. So thank you again for coming, and for those viewers out there, if you have more questions, check out the website, call Ashley or any of us here. And for those of you in the audience, thank you for coming today.
Thank you very much.